Hi, we are live now. This is Subhash Dhar from San Francisco, California, doing our second in the series of the Bangalore's event of BITOSA Global Conclave, the second webinar in the series. The first one we had Himanshu Nautiyal from Euler Systems, and today we have a very distinguished guest from India, from in Delhi. Let me welcome Sudipto Majumdar. Sudip, you're there.
Hi, everybody. I'm glad to be here and great to speak to somebody as distinguished as Subhash. Okay.
Well, it's our pleasure, Sudip, to have you on this webinar chat series. Just for the people who are joining us for the first time, I just want them to know that we have started this webinar chat series to discuss issues and opportunities for the tech community. While there are many tech conferences in the world and there are many tech chats in the world, there's not so much discussion on what happens to the life of the tech worker themselves or the tech professionals. So the focus of this webinar chat series is to look at all kinds of technologies and developments in the world, but in the context of life and work of a tech professional. So that's what this chat series is about. And this is in the run-up for a summit event in Bangalore on December 1st. So you can mark your calendars. On December 1st, there is a BITOSA Global Conclave, which is happening in Bangalore. And that is really going to be about how the new sharing economy, the gig economy, is impacting the life, work, and play of tech professionals. So having said that, let me give you a little bit more on Sudipto Majumdar, our guest for today. Sudipto has had a long career in technology, over 25 years. He's obviously by training, he's a graduate of the Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay, and Indian Institute of Management, Bangalore, where he and I met. So we've known each other since then. Sudipto has worked as director of engineering at Yahoo. Then he has worked with several other companies like Zapac and Reliance, Big Entertainment. Most notably, recently, he was a head of digital business at ICICI Prudential Life Insurance Company. But he has been a serial entrepreneur always that I have known him. And I think he has now become a full-time entrepreneur once again and an investor. So there's plenty of technology revisions that he has seen in his life. He has seen a lot of exits, a lot of startup getting formed. So I think we have in him today somebody who has seen the transformation of how the work of technology has gone through since the late 80s up to now. We couldn't have a better guest to discuss the future of work in tech today. So without further ado, I'll sort of dive in. Sudip, you wanted to sort of say a little bit more about yourself before we get into the questions?
Okay, I'll just give a small pointer. So I'm one of those guys who loves and who is proud to be a coder. You know, there are two kinds of people in our profession. One who become managers and the others who remain techies all their lives. So I code till this day. I'm 50 plus and I still code. And I code every day. Okay. So I am a lot more closer, the engineer rather than the manager. So keeping that in mind, it's not that I still have to do the dirty job of HR appraisals and, you know, client meetings. Okay. But that's not where my passion lies. Okay.
Well, I hope there are no HR professionals on this webinar. But you know, I know there's always a love-hate relationship between the techies and the management roles of the company. I've come from my one such company myself, and I've been on the other side. Started as a programmer, but ended up being on the other side. And you know how that when that religion changes, it's not appreciated by the techies at all.
Yeah.
So let's dive into the meat of the webinar chat. So before we get into tech jobs, I think it would be good to give some background to the listeners about how you know the jobs are getting impacted in general in other industries thanks to technology. I mean, do you feel that you know the traditional jobs you know which we have known, you know, the old farm sector, then the factories, and then you know more recent the services businesses like the agencies and the consultants and experts and you know they're all getting Sudeep, do you think they are getting disrupted significantly, or it is something that's on the fringe that we have been hearing so far? And what do you think is going to happen in the future on those jobs?
So when we talk of change, the first thing that I'd like to quote is something called the Amara's Law, you know, which basically profoundly says that we overestimate the change in the short run and underestimate the change in the long run. So because we get very excited and say, oh, AI is going to do wonderful things and all that, and after 3 years, you say, nothing really has changed. And yet, if you look back after 15 years, you might find, I mean, look at the cell phone for that matter. I mean, everything in the world has changed. But when we started using a cell phone, the first 1 or 2 years, we found that nothing much had changed, really. So this is what I'm noticing, the same cycle starting with, of course, AI is one of the things, but not just AI. It is I think the overall connectedness of everything to everything. You know, what I mean by that is, like today, if I just did a transaction to buy some mutual funds directly from a mutual fund company. Now, this technology is so old that I should have been able to do this 20 years ago also. Okay, I mean, there's nothing. You're filling in some forms, it's going into some database. Why 20 years? Probably 30 years ago also, I should have been able to do that. But I couldn't, because it wasn't just technology that was the theoretical part of the technology that was stopping it. It was things like connectivity, regulation, blah, 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 which take their own time to, you know, come to the point where I could do a one-click purchase of that mutual fund without going through any intermediary. So then similarly, sorry, a lot of things have happened which are enablers to what if we had envisaged maybe when we were graduating from college. This is how things will happen, are actually happening now somewhere after 25 years of our thing. So what are the new things that are happening? Okay, of course, the first thing is AI, and I'm going to talk a little bit about it. In fact, let me first talk about it because, you know, it sets the tone. So I'll take something that is not very obvious in mind, in the sense that, you know, the first wave of digitization really did not displace too many jobs, because, you know, you needed to do all the thinking and the everything a human being had to do it. The best that the digitization did was made it more efficient. In a law firm, you'd still require those hundreds of junior level employees to be doing discovery. In a typical large law firm, they would have to go through. Previously, they would be reading through hundreds of manuals. Now they can do the same thing through digitized format where it's indexed and cross-referenced, blah, blah, blah. So that was the first way of when the number of people really did not reduce. But now what we find is that in the same law firm, I'm speaking from some experience in a US-based law firm, which I can't mention for confidentiality, is that a typically large corporate account, or let's say a corporate case, might require 20 junior level, I don't know what they call, associates, that's what I think called. They were typically about 3-4 years into the job from law school. They would have about 20 people working for a month or 1 month and a half in something called a discovery process, where each one would read case law and, you know, pass on their notings to the partner who would then take up a significant part of it and build up a case. Now, that same law firm today employs about 4 to 5 of such people instead of 20. What has changed is that a lot of the digging that was being done manually is now run through pattern matching recognitions and AI. Okay, but it's basically, I should be calling it machine learning rather than AI, because you know, purists get very rankled. There's nothing like AI. Okay, it's machine learning, which is true. So what we find is that it's not that now, for the first time, white collar jobs, which in many ways were routine. So the same thing I am noticing in one content company is that they would have a lot of young guys who would be doing trolling through all the news in the morning and then making small baskets of interesting news, which would then be packaged and repackaged and put into an app. A lot of that is now being trawled through. The first level is being done through machines, right? So these are definitely places where there is some amount of displacement of white collar jobs is happening. But it's all happening at the lower end jobs, which it's still not reached the upper end. And at least with the technology we have or can foresee for the next 10, 15 years, it is not going to threaten anybody who's 10 years experience or 8 years experience. It is threatening the people. Unfortunately, it is threatening the people who get their 10-year experience by going through that matter of doing the rigmarole and things like that. Having said that, it is not that those people are completely being displaced, because you still require a few people to trudge through whatever the machine is putting out.
Okay. All right. No, that's awesome. I think that opens it up to another question, another phenomenon that we are seeing, that a lot of the job impact which we are seeing today is, and it's been argued that while on one hand some jobs are getting sort of impacted significantly, there are new jobs getting created in what is being called as the gig economy. So while you may not have as many 9-to-5 long-term jobs, but there are so many gigs which are coming in. There are so many platforms which are offering you gigs to do something, get just-in-time jobs and sort of go from there. But then the argument is it really expanding the job, the job horizon for overall? A. B. Is it a sustainable job that this gig economy is creating? Or will it continue to be a job on the side? You still need, and you will still need 10 years from now, 20 years from now, your 9-to-5 jobs. Do you have a view on that?
Yeah, see, actually the gig, forget the gig economy, that's a new word that has been coined. But gigs have always been there for the last 100 years. So you would have a handyman, okay?
Right.
You have a small section of the people who always did gigs, right? Who never had a stable job. At that point, the reason was that probably most of them weren't qualified enough to be having a blue collar or a white collar job. And it was a very small niche, because there was that information asymmetry was there. I mean, I need somebody in a part of a town. How do I get easily that person to do that? Information asymmetry is going away, so that somebody can jump into that place because of a smartphone or whatever it is. So it is not a new thing that gig economy has opened up. It's just that because of a lot of connectivity, I don't mean the simplistic sense of just a mobile phone. It's the systems which are built on top of systems which enable this entire thing to happen, which has expanded the number of people who can do gigs. I see that. So a typical example people give is of Uber, right? Listen, it's displacing taxi drivers with people who are doing gigs. I would say that it's an unfortunate example, because taxis were always a very inefficient service in every city in the world.
Right.
Most places in the world, they ripped you off. Okay, because you had in New York, you have the medallion system, in India, you have the licensing system, whatever you want to call it. So actually, in many ways, Uber has two different things that is. One is it's disrupted and made the transportation more efficient, which has got nothing to do really with gig, but does require temporary workers. So that's why it becomes gig. But mind you, I think the Uber's end game is not those temporary workers. They want to have automated workers, automated drivers.
Right.
That's truly the end game. Gig economy is, I think, just overrated because of that. What will happen is, yes, there will be probably a lot more people working on gigs, but because of expanded information. Okay. It is not probably going to replace regular work, whatever the regular work is going to be replaced probably by other things like what we talked about, you know, like the AI or reducing right. the people required.
Okay.
For example, my this is a shameless plug, but my current startup, okay, it has got one of the objectives is that it wants to reduce one person from the front desk of a hotel on an average. So typically, in a mid-sized hotel, you require 2.5 to 3 people in a front desk who are working in the daytime and about 1 to 1.5 person working in the nighttime. So the idea is, can I remove one person out of it? Okay. So that those are the kind of things that are happening. Obviously, there are new jobs which are opening up for them.
Of course. But
unfortunately, as of now, what it seems is most of the jobs which are opening up are on the higher end of the scale. So I can't find enough programmers. I can't find enough. And here I'm not talking about the low-end program. I'm talking about people who think of data structures and algorithms. But not everybody is suited to do the job. They don't want to do the job. Frankly, I don't have an answer to what is going to happen about it.
Well, that's a great segue into the actual topic that we have. So let's sort of get into that and stop beating around the bush. But I just thought this background was important, that there's an impact on the jobs as we know it. At the same time, so far you just said you're eliminating one job in every hotel, but hopefully that job, and that's hope more than reality, hopefully that job is what another platform company will generate, say something like Oyo, or somebody like Oyo or Make My Trip will generate where this person can go. But we are not so sure about it. And as you rightly said, jobs that are getting created and non-tech jobs that are getting created in platform companies are really of not the same nature as the one which was there old. But let's talk a little bit about the tech jobs, right? I mean, so if you also eliminate for example, every hotel has a tech team. Why should they have the tech team when there is a platform like yours, or there are many other platforms you're coming, which will do a lot of the tech work that they would have done in terms of reservation, revenue management, and so on. So therefore, for the tech professional, what is the promise? Are the jobs going to shrink in numbers, but increase in quality, or it's going to increase in numbers, increase in quality, both, or no, they're going to shrink both in terms of numbers and maybe in terms of quality, that they will not be needed to do programming anymore, but just do data massaging or something like that?
So my view is extremely optimistic on the tech side.
Okay.
Only on the tech side, unfortunately. Okay. Which is that probably the best is yet to come for the technology professionals. Because, if you look at the first wave of automation in the 80s, it was mostly offices and that to large enterprises. Okay, because they could afford all that kind of budget. And then it percolated down to medium enterprises. And now, I don't think even an individual can think of working without some amount of automation. Sorry. But bad cold, okay. So, but the way that automation happens, or rather that automation is being created, is no longer customized. You're trying, because obviously you cannot have each individual making their own software or getting somebody to make their own software. It's getting bundled into general purpose software, which the user can customize to a certain extent. But that is still scratching the surface. every aspect of our entire life is slowly getting connected and digitized. I mean, there are about 30% of the nights I order food, and the only thing I do is really look at my smartphone. I click on something and I, you know, click something and it gets paid and I get it delivered. Now, that kind of reliability of service is, again, something I could have, we could have done 10, 15 years ago, but the technology always existed. But why it happens now is because, A, of course, of better connectivity, but B, also because a lot of programmers have built infrastructures, APIs, connectivities, and this is not going to end. I mean, it's just going to, more and more aspects would be digitization. More and more aspects. So even if I have the funkiest of AI, which can think of things, that still require low-level digitization all across the world, in places in Africa, so that I can get the cheapest good from there. So tomorrow, probably Africa would become the hub of, you know, from where I can get the cheapest goods. So another one or two generations would definitely require to do a lot of conventional programming that we do. And here I'm not even getting to training in AI or something like that, just conventional programming.
All right.
Okay. I'll be the enterprise. So the jobs may be, a lot of those may be the SME sector or something that an entrepreneur may have to do. Okay.
Right.
Because the enterprise, the large enterprises like the TCS and the Infosys of the world are already connected to the large enterprises, and that part is fairly saturated. But there are still a lot of automation to be done in general. A few of the automation will also be entrepreneur driven. This is that you think of all the startups. So, for example, my startup is doing something in the sector of hospitality and more specifically in the sector of hotels, right? What is it? It is connecting very small hotels in Dharmashala, Shimla, and, you know, places that normally were never connected, and they used to run on those Khata books, you know, the books.
Right.
To big OTAs like Expedia, and so that even a Japanese guy can book in some weird village in Leh or Ladakh or someplace like that. So,
right.
But it is not driven by large corporation. It is driven by entrepreneurship.
Right.
Okay.
And platforms. I mean, and digital platforms that the entrepreneurs are building. Before we get into the next one.
My point was, a lot of those jobs may be self-employed jobs.
Ah, okay.
Corporate job.
Awesome. But before we get into the next question, I just wanted the, I think we have a significant number of participants here. Unfortunately, the system will not allow the participants to speak up, but I know you are interested. So we have a feature on the Zoom product which you're using, which is Q&A. So if you see the menu and if you can click on Q&A, you can put your question in there, which I will be able to read and then sort of ask Sudipto here. And so please sort of start trickling it in as we go ahead and ask the next question to Sudip. So Sudip, great point. I think a lot of the jobs will be generated not necessarily by large enterprises as we know them today, or for that matter, service providers as we know them today, but a whole number of new digital companies which will be either founded by, which will be very small and therefore not having too many jobs. But then there are other which become very big and very large scale, like, you know, we are talking about Amazon or Uber or Oyo or Airbnb and so on, which are some very large platforms started by entrepreneurs nevertheless, very small companies to start with, but to have now become companies which employ up to tens of thousands of people, not very small compared to so-called the TCS and Infosys. And if you look at the value of jobs and the salaries which are being paid there, I think they are the most envied jobs and not the large IT service providers. So there are going to be some very large platform companies out of the new digital economy that you speak of, which are giving these jobs. Now, my point though there is, are two points. One, is it like for every 25 jobs which will get eliminated in 25 hotels, there will be three jobs which will be created by the hotel aggregator? That is so that's a number problem. And second, those three jobs, by the way, will not demand the same skills which the 25 jobs were demanding in 25 different hotels, right? So just speak to that skill and to the number, if you will.
Yeah, so you're absolutely right. The number of so the same function still requires human beings, because if I were to see, typically what we do is we think of a process, see, okay, this is repetitive, and then we make a system for it and let the automation take over. But the process is never 100% without the intervention of humans. So you still require humans. But the fact that now that small trickle of 100 processes have been put into one big fire hose means that you require fewer people, but highly skilled people to be able to manage that big fire hose. So yeah, 25 to 3 is probably a good kind of a ratio in which that particular job is getting shrunk from 25 people to 33 people. And out of those 25 people, a few might be able to upgrade to a skill set or that, but most won't be able to do it because they might not have the same skill set, and it might require slightly different skill sets to do the same job on an automated system. So as I said, that I don't have a very optimistic view about those kind of jobs. But if I were to come back to techies, techies are still in demand. If you know how to code, obviously you are still in demand. So that's at least for one or two generations I can think of, is that's not going to change. So especially the biggest thing we are talking about is not AI. The biggest demand for techies will be with the explosion of IoTs. And there are sensors put in every small thing, starting from, let's say, your pizza delivery packet to your car, maybe having 30 different, car already has 30 different sensors, but always connected sensors. You require all that data flow to be programmed, sliced and diced into reports. You need that control systems to be made which can then take the right action. Some data flow will go to your insurance company from the car. Some data might go to your parents if it's a child who's a young adult who's driving the car. So who's going to make those systems? So we require a lot of new systems. So awesome. Programmers are safe for the moment.
Okay. So there's one question which is coming from our listeners. Somit, I can't figure out exactly where he's from, but Somit, I think must be from India because the question is relevant to India. I think, all as AI and all of these advanced technologies will take over, and more jobs will demand some of these machine learning and IoT and all of those things. His question is that he believes that the Indian college education system is going to be a constraint, where there apparently it's the college education system is not that strong, and people are feeling the need to migrate to other countries to do their masters and PhDs and so on, which will be required for these higher technologies. I'm not sure whether you agree with that, but that's his point. And if that's going to be the case, then if people are going to migrate, so will the jobs. I mean, if these jobs are going to need higher skills and they are not going to be so easily developed in India, will the jobs therefore not come to India as much as they have come in the past?
Okay, it's a tough one. Partly I agree with him. The Indian college system, for most part, not all of it, but for most part, has been broken for some years now, especially computer science studies. So let me give you a confession. When I hire people for programming, as a software developer, so I hire people directly from college, out of college to about 3-4 years, to about 8-10 years, 15 years. So it's very unfair to a guy who's just coming out of college to ask him, something complex, because he doesn't have any work experience. So what I do is I ask him simple things. Sometimes I ask him very simple thing like, tell me your all CS courses of a second year. So he's done a 4-year course, right? And every two semesters in their schools. And I find that a lot of them, they're smart people, they're not dumb guys, but they don't remember even the names of those courses. Forget, you know, asking them what something about data structures or algorithms, they don't even remember the course, Because there has not been a lot of rigor in the tier 2 and tier 3 colleges of our country. Okay. So we've created a lot of quantity with very little quality. So that part I agree. Where I think the things are changing in India also is that, so in the first wave of the big company like Infosys, TCS and Wipro became the $1 billion companies in India, first few $1 billion companies in India, the requirement was very simple. You know, you had a certain, most clients would come up and say that this is what I need made. A lot of it either had already been made, which needed to be just tweaked and developed, or they were in later parts. You had the these big companies had developed platforms and stacks, which needed just you needed to do very standard coding on that and get the solution done. And that kind of work will still be required. Okay. But that is not the growing end of the spectrum. The end of the spectrum of the tech jobs is where you can give solutions. And here again, I'm talking about the non-enterprise clients. Right. Enterprise clients remain roughly the same. Okay. Uh-huh. But enterprise clients have stagnated to a certain extent. Most of the growth is now from non-enterprise clients. And non-enterprise clients are looking for solutions where the techie has to first of all think about the solution before he can think of the code.
Okay. So they have to know about the business domain, the situation in that they're the problem that you're trying to solve before you get into the technology part of it.
Yeah. And so, that's where I find that. And so while you can give an excuse that we weren't taught too well in college, and which is true to a certain extent, there's no excuse to the fact that Indian guys cannot think very well in terms of solution.
Okay.
So it just today, there was somebody who asked me that, you know, I am doing this development in Ukraine, some mobile apps, right? Okay. But I can do it a lot cheaper in India from what I can see from the cost. Should I get it done? And since he was my friend and I didn't want any harm done to him, I said that think 10 times because I know you go to Ukraine and you tell them on a whiteboard, this is what I done. And you don't know how much work that goes behind that to make it into a logical concept.
Correct.
Because you would be jumping your thoughts all over the place. They actually make it into a, you know, a product flow. They, you know, keep data consistent and things like that. And then they code. They also code, but that's when they code. Most Indian companies are either very bad in doing that or don't know how to do that. So I think that what is required in India is not just blame the college system, which is bad, okay, but also to culturally change. And we have been discussing this, that one of the big things that even Indians get when they go to Silicon Valley is exposure. Hmm. It's not that suddenly they know more of Java or more of C++.
I think business models and
they get to know this is how a business works. This is how I should architect a solution. Those are the things that you don't get to know here. So getting an MBA from abroad is not going to help as much as getting exposure to the right place.
That's a great point. Hey guys, unfortunately, we have designed this webinars to be just about 20-25 minutes. We are right at the end of our time. There are so many questions here, Sudipto. I will actually send you these questions. They are very interesting. But even better than that, let me also formally invite you to the BITOSA Global Conclave, which is happening on the open event, which is on December 1st in Bangalore at the Lalit Hotel. I sincerely hope you can make it there. I would love to have you. As we can tell, there's people here who would want their questions to be answered. So, and there are so many more questions which are just pouring in. It looks like it all starts after the 20th minute or 25th minute of the webinar. I wish I had these beforehand. So maybe, you know, our organizers can think about getting some questions upfront also, and we can sort of release the blurb. But I think this webinar was supposed to be a teaser to the real event, and where we can we will discuss this in many, many dimensions. You're thinking you've just scratched the surface, but believe me, I've got so many questions out here which I'm tempted to ask. I don't have enough time. I think we have just enough time to sort of thank you and thank everyone who came to this webinar, and we just hope that you will be with us at the event on December 1st. So thanks once again, Sudeep, for joining us here.
Thank you very much for having me. I'll definitely try to make it. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.